Hey, Dr. Osborne here, and today I want to talk about Grainbecity. Grainbecity is the term that basically defines how consuming high levels or high quantities of grain can actually lead to obesity. If you've not heard this term before, pay close attention because it might just be the solution for improving your pain, for improving your weight if you're struggling with weight loss. So let's dive in. How do grains cause weight gain and inflammation? So we look at this diagram, you can see grain consumption. One of the big problems with grain is that even though despite all of what you hear, there's a lot of what people talk about with grain is that grains are healthy and that grains are a balanced part of your breakfast and that you should consume lots of grains in your diet. But the reality is that when you're consuming grains, it comes with this kind of bastion of toxins. And so let's go through this list. Number one is heavy metals. For example, if we're talking about heavy metals, rice, a number of studies on rice, especially those of you with celiac disease who buy a bunch of gluten-free products that contain high amounts of rice flour. Look, rice has been shown to contain high levels of cadmium, arsenic, and lead. And these are toxic heavy metals. They can contribute to a disruption of your internal chemistry that leads to hormone imbalance, that leads to chronic inflammation. So it's very important that you understand these toxic metals aren't good for your body. And gravitating toward those rice-based products, especially if you're on a traditional gluten-free diet where you're avoiding wheat, barley, and rye, but still eating corn and rice, understand you're still getting heavy metal. Corn has been shown, especially corn syrups, have been shown to contain mercury. So when you combine mercury and cadmium and lead and arsenic into your diet on a regular, consistent basis, what that can do is create major health issues. And those health issues lead to inflammation, and that inflammation, as we'll talk about in a minute, can contribute to obesity. Now, one of the other problems around grain consumption is omega-6. And we're talking about not omega-6 being bad for you, because you need some omega-6. They're an essential fat, but it's excessive omega-6. Grains are hugely excessive in omega-6. So if grains are part of your staple diet, you have to understand that when you take in excessive omega-6, you actually tilt the balance in your body toward inflammation. So your body's more prone to creating larger quantities of inflammation on a regular daily basis. So you don't want excessive omega-6. You want to balance that out. You need omega-6 and omega-3 kind of in a 2-to-1 ratio, ideally speaking. And when you're on a grain-heavy diet, that ratio for many Americans is more like 20-to-1 omega-6 to omega-3. So that creates a huge inflammatory imbalance. One of the other components about grain that we've seen and that we've studied is we know it can cause leaky gut, and especially leaky gut in terms of the gluten, okay, that can also be found in grain. So gluten, aside from those of you with celiac disease, there's non-celiac gluten sensitivity, and many of you react to gluten, and it can create and contribute to leaky gut, or think of leaky gut as little microscopic pinholes in your GI tract that allow for the waste products in your gut to leak into your bloodstream, creating a slow poisoning effect. And that's not what you want to be healthy. Then we also have the fact that grains are have contain omega, or rather, grains contain excessive carbohydrates. And excessive carbohydrates break down into sugar, and too much sugar, when your body has too much of it, not only does your blood sugar go up, increasing your risk for heart disease, diabetes, and cancer, but your body takes excessive sugar and converts it into fat. That's what we call triglycerides. And so many people over consuming carbs end up getting fatter, even though they may be eating a low fat diet, because carbs are very easily converted into fat by the body. You don't want excess carbohydrate in your diet. One of the other factors is mold. And I'm going to just skip down here too to mycotoxins, mold and the toxins that mold can produce. So mold and mycotoxins aren't the same thing. Think of a mycotoxin as the poop that mold excretes. Now, 5% of the population is allergic to mold. So, grain is heavily contaminated with mold, but mycotoxins are another issue. Mycotoxin exposure over long periods of time has been linked to cancer. It's been linked to kidney disease. It's been linked to immunosuppression. So suppressing the immune system, making a person more susceptible to infections and other problems, other health issues. So you don't want to consume high levels of molds or mycotoxins because of their deleterious health effects. And again, just like I said earlier about the people that have celiac that are eating and consuming the corn and the rice, that's where we find most of the mold and the mycotoxin is in the corn and the rice. So you have to be careful in that regard. Then we have pesticides. Pesticides, and we'll combine pesticides with GMO because genetically modified organisms, some grains are GMO, like corn, for example. Most of the corn grown in the country is genetically modified, but Likewise, most of the corn grown that way is sprayed with pesticide, and particularly one called glyphosate, which has recently been highly linked to cancer. And, you know, there was a major lawsuit where a gentleman developed cancer as a result of glyphosate or Roundup, and he won the lawsuit. So again, if you're consuming high levels of grains, no, you're getting heavy levels of glyphosate or heavy levels of Roundup in your food as well. And that's dangerous. There have been a number of studies showing, you know, cereals like Cheerios and other major brands being contaminated with high levels of glyphosate. So, again, grain comes with that glyphosate, which, aside from it being a pesticide, glyphosate can act as a neutralizing agent for your healthy bacteria in your gut. So imagine now it's like getting exposure to an antibiotic on a regular basis where you're stripping away your good probiotics, your good microbiome. Then we have other pesticides that mimic estrogens. And so women, this increases your risk of cardiovascular disease. It can increase your risk of breast cancer. Men, same thing. It can increase your risk of different kinds of cancers, but also can slow down your ability to produce adequate muscle. Then we have ATIs. This is some of the newer research coming out on grains. ATI stands for amylase trypsin inhibitor. And this is a substance that has been shown to cause major inflammation in the GI tract, also leading to a leaky gut. But amylase trypsin inhibitors also can slow down digestion. They can block your body's ability to digest food. And when you're not digesting your food, you're not extrapolating the vitamins and the minerals and the other nutrients from it. You become malnourished and your body becomes more susceptible to chronic disease. Now, all of these things, when combined, what do? They lead to inflammation. Inflammation creates an elevation in different hormones. And one of those hormones is your stress hormone, which is called cortisol. Now, cortisol is very, very critical. Your body makes more cortisol because cortisol works like a fire truck. It puts out the fire. So if you're chronically eating food that's causing chronic fires, you're making more and more cortisol over time on a daily basis. And when you make too much cortisol over time, chronic elevations in cortisol have been shown to cause weight gain and muscle loss. Any of you who have ever taken a steroid given by your doctor, like a corticosteroid or prednisone, and found that you retained a lot of water, gained a bunch of weight, and felt different afterwards, this is why, because excessive cortisol causes water retention, weight gain, and muscle loss. Now, we follow the logic here. Muscle loss leads to a shortened muscle. When your muscles are shorter, your joints are compressed. And so that's what you're seeing up here, joint compression and pain. And what happens when we're in pain? When our muscles are weaker and we're in pain, we tend to avoid exercise, sit on the couch more, not do as much. And that can lead to, obviously, greater degrees of weight gain. So obviously, exercise avoidance leads to more weight gain. If we're chronically inflamed, this cycle just repeats itself over and over and over again. That's why it's called the grain obesity cycle. Now let's talk strategy. Let's talk about what you can do to recover from this type of problem. So strategies in regard to getting this knocked out. Number one, avoid grain. Obviously, we've been talking about that the whole time. And I wrote a book called No Grain, No Pain with all the science in it. There's more than 300 medical references documenting what I'm telling you in this video. And so avoiding grain is the first step. Number two, stay hydrated, getting plenty of adequate water. Remember, you're 70% water, and water's part of how we detoxify. Water's very important to deliver nutrition. Many people get dehydrated when they become overweight, and that makes their joints hurt even more, and that creates even more problems related to exercise. Number three, sweat. Sweat is one of the ways we get rid of toxins. If you are not sweating on a regular basis because you're not exercising, obviously one of the ways we do sweat is through exercise, then use an infrared sauna. Infrared saunas can be a very effective way to sweat when your joints hurt too much to exercise. So if you're kind of just getting into this and you're in a lot of pain, this is a great way to begin the process, but it's going to help you rid toxins out of your body. And many of these toxins that are from the grains themselves. But we all are encountering toxins on a daily basis. It's not just the toxins in grain. And if your body's overwhelmed by toxins and you're not sweating properly, you're going to store those toxins in your fat cells. And so how do we get them out? Well, we sweat. And infrared is one of the best ways to get rid of them so that your body has a greater capacity for healing and repairing and not having to be overwhelmed by direct overexposure to toxins. Stretching. Stretching stimulates lymphatic flow in the body, helps you get rid of toxins, but also loosens the muscles and takes the pressure off the joints. So again, if you're not able to do resistance activity or exercise, stretching is a great way to begin. Combining sweating in an infrared sauna with stretching, two excellent ways to really begin the process to recover from grain obesity. Walking 10,000 steps a day as a goal. Some people can't walk quite that far. They're you know, their weight, they're 70, 80, 90 pounds or more overweight, and just they have a limit to what they can do in a day. So start low. Don't think if you can't get to 10,000 that you shouldn't do anything. Start with 2,000. And as you get lose a little bit of weight and feel a little bit better, increase your step counts every day until you get up to 10,000. That's ideal. Light bodyweight exercises. We're not talking about heavy weights, folks. We're not talking about getting under a squat rack and blowing your knees out. We're talking about basic bodyweight movements, jumping jacks, squats without weight, just bodyweight squats. We're talking about plank holds, jump rope, sit-ups, push-ups, basic stuff, right? Burpees if you can do them, like really, really simple bodyweight exercises that are going to help you regain muscle, right? So that you can start moving in the right direction. Then we have omega-3 fatty acids. Remember, many of you with grain obesity problems have a huge imbalance in your omega-6 to omega-3 fatty acid ratio, causing more inflammation. So pushing up your omega-3s is a very good way to kind of help bring that balance back. So how can we do that? We can eat more grass-fed beef. We can eat wild-caught fish, because especially cold water wild-caught fish, because it's high in omega-3. Flax and chia are plant-based sources of omega-3 if you're a vegetarian. Making sure you're getting adequate quantity of omega-3 to rebalance that inflammation. And then two, taking a turmeric supplement. Look, turmeric is highly, highly studied for its anti-inflammatory effect. And when we're trying to put out the fire, we want to give the body help so that the cortisol has the capacity to kind of start to balance itself back out. And so using turmeric can be a very, very effective strategy, especially higher doses. 2 to 4 grams of turmeric a day can be very, very effective. Some people will grate turmeric and add it to their smoothies. That's a great way to do it in the diet. So these 8 strategies should help you go a long way if you're struggling with grain obesity to make that recovery. Now, what I want you to do, if you have had this experience, if you have had your journey from grain obesity to normal weight and feeling great, share your story below. Your story might help change somebody else's life. And remember, our mission at Gluten Free Society is to save 100 million lives. And so if you can share your story, that would be fantastic. If you haven't, comment below. If you've got questions, comment below. We'll do our best to get the answers to you. We're here for you. We want to help you. And as always, if you haven't subscribed, make sure you hit that subscribe button and come visit us at glutenfreesociety.org. If you're not already a member over there, sign up for your free gluten-free survival guide. We'll get that to your inbox. All you have to do is punch your email in. Have a great day. We'll see you in the next video.